can't have.
Now listen, you
the right of
stop calling me a crypto Nazi.
Let's stop calling
I'll
names.
You in
let's
your goddamn
get...
face, and
let's...
you'll stay plastered.
Would you call God material or immaterial?
Immaterial.
What is something that's immaterial?
Something not extended in space.
Hmm. Can you give me an example of anything other than God that's immaterial?
Loss of logic.
Uh-oh.
This educational system is going to fail you. I graduated from college believing exactly as you believe.
Yep. Exactly as you believe. All right, here we go. 40 Ounce Hemlock, episode 29. Drop the beat. Ladies and gentlemen, it's 40 Ounce Hemlock Podcast, episode 29. My name is Nick. This is part 9 of the Unmasking Antifa series, and we are back, and I'm ready to go. Man, I'm really excited about this show. We're going to be going an hour today. And possibly for the last episode of the series as well. This is sort of a practical adjustment I'm making at the behest of a trusted audience member who said, look, just go for an hour. Why not go for an hour? People can pause. And I thought about it. I'm like, yeah, you know, that's right. Why put the artificial endpoint on a discussion? Because in certain, obviously, you know, in certain circumstances, we come to the 30-minute mark and I'm like, got to stop here, but we're in the middle of it, so we'll pick back up. Why put an artificial endpoint on my end when I can just leave the flexibility on your end to just push pause, you know, on your commute to school or work or during your workout or in between classes, or just push pause and come back whenever it's convenient for you? Why not just leave it in your hands? Freedom is a good thing, right? So that's what I'm going to do. Today's going to be an hour, and we should get to it. Oh, right. Who am I? What am I? Oh, well, actually, I set out to do this episode the other night. Real late at night. Technically speaking, it was about 2:30 in the morning, but I just got so motivated. I was so excited. I wanted to do it. And I said, who am I? What am I? I'm a guy who thinks that sometimes some good things happen after 2 a.m., you know, contrary to conventional wisdom. But then I had like an hour of technical difficulties, gave up, and went to bed. So I guess now I'm a guy who believes that nothing good happens after 2 a.m., you know, until further notice. So let's get started. We got about 56 minutes here, and we're going to need all of them. We're closing in on the mark here. You know, I've been saying we're going to touch on this historical point about Antifa. I'm going to make clear what Antifa's connection is to Marxism and communism. And then in the last episode of this series, which will be the next one, part 10, we are going to take the mask. We're going to take the mask off Antifa and see who is the face behind the mask. Don't miss it. But to do that, and this episode, that is, I'm going to need some moral support. Hey, Fife, I need some moral support. What is going to be the approach for the next 50 minutes or so?
When the mic is in my hand, I'm never hesitant.
That's good. It's like no matter how many times you say it, Fife, that's good. Actually, you know what? One more time, because this is really important, and this is just really important stuff we're talking about today. Just one more time. Like, if you were in my shoes, when you're doing your thing, what's your approach?
When the mic is in my hand, I'm never hesitant.
All right, let's do it. Let's not hesitate. Quick review. Might be fair, right? So we saw what Marxism is over and above communism, right? I mean, this was the whole point of the past two episodes, was to make clear what it is that Marx adds to communism. And this is so important to understand Antifa. Why? Well, because we saw that what Marx adds is a sort of, well, I'm going to call it a rhetorical device at best. It's certainly not a rational device, because the whole point of the device is to invalidate the rationality of the opponent so they don't have to be engaged rationally. And I said, now ask yourself, why is it that you see Antifa roll up into venues where a speaker is speaking publicly with whom they disagree? And what do? Do they raise their hand in the Q&A, you know, and rationally engage and argue and debate? No. They burn, loot, riot, intimidate, beat, you know, etc. Because what the opponent has to say is not important. Because for Marx, the entire mode of consciousness of the opponent, everything about his mind, is determined right down to the logic, right? Is determined by this class structure. So everything he might say and think is just a function of the role, the class he occupies in society. So for anyone outside that class to engage him would just be to buy into those assumptions and thus continue to be oppressed by him. So the only solution is to revolt against him, to shout him down, to beat him down, whatever it takes. Again, just to reemphasize this point, what Marx said about laws, not just laws in the legal sense, but the very, you know, supposedly, according to Marx, the eternal laws of morality, including concepts like personal freedom and thus political freedom, on which the laws of the land are based. And not just moral laws and principles, but all supposedly abstract, invariant laws. And this would include the laws of logic. Everything, says Marx, is a product of this class struggle. And the rich, the haves, right, the bourgeoisie, according to Marx, impose, you know, like Thrasymachus said when we read the old passage from Socrates, or from Plato, rather. Thrasymachus says to Socrates, Socrates, what you don't understand about justice is you think it's this abiding thing that, you know, is binding to everyone, but what you don't see is it's just something that the rich impose on the poor. So the poor go on about their business thinking that real concepts like the right to property and the right to personal and political freedom and things like this and liberty and things like this are real. But what they don't realize is that's just what the rich have built into their minds to get them to remain where they are so the rich can go on as they want to. Okay, so the justice, says Thrasymachus, is the advantage of the stronger. And this is exactly what Marx said. And he takes it all the way to not just the laws of justice, not just moral principles underpinning, you know, political concepts, abstract political concepts like justice and freedom, but all the way down to logic itself, all of it, the entire mode of consciousness, says Marx. Logic included, rational thinking included, is in the same boat. So there's no need to rationally engage the supposed putative oppressor. You just overthrow them. All right? Now, just at the beginning of this episode, I want to dwell on this point about logic, because this is going to touch something that we're going to do here right at the top. Logic itself, says Marx, is a product of material forces. And in society, just to bring it full circle, those material forces are most distinctly realized in the clash between social classes, especially the main two social classes, the haves and the have-nots, the latter of which are oppressed by the former, again, with such a thoroughgoing oppression, such an all-encompassing oppression, that the very rational categories and principles, i.e. laws, and moral categories and principles and laws, in which the have-nots conduct their thinking, is actually a tool that is being used against them, imposed on them by the haves. And so, again, sorry to reemphasize this, but it's important, everything must be thrown off, destroyed, torn down, uprooted. Uprooted. You know, the word radical, if you look at the word eradicate, eradicate means to pull out, right? It's the same root word, rad, root, okay? Pulled up from the roots, leaving nothing remaining. The haves cannot, should not even be argued with. For to argue with this particular opponent would be to buy into the very structure of rationality that he, your oppressor, has imposed on you. So what do? Burn it down. Burn everything down. Okay, so there's the review. Now, and this should go some distance, I think, in just explaining the behavior of Antifa, but we're going to make good on this promise to more closely connect Antifa with what I've been saying about Marx and communism. But I want to do something here at the beginning that's going to seem slightly out of place at first, but then it's going to pay huge dividends, and I think it's going to just shed an incredible amount of light on this. Just in general, I'm a big fan, I'm a big proponent of old books, all right? You got to read the old books. Yes, there's, you know, you're a college student, you're a grad student or whatever, or you're just a, you know, enthusiast on the shelves at Barnes & Noble or whatever, you know, you want to grab that, go to the new release. You got to read old books, dusty books, books with brown pages, all right? There's nothing like the smell of old dusty brown pages mixed with coffee in the morning, okay? You got to do it. You got to experience it. You'll get hooked, okay? But it's not just an aesthetic thing. You got to read old books because the problems that many in our society, the intellectual problems and issues that many, and this is touching on our first series from Darwin to Donald Trump, are trying to convince you are long in the rearview mirror and we've moved past them and they have the solutions to them and on we march. Problems from way back, very significant problems, are still with us. And you can really get a sense of how significant they are by hearing the original folks who expounded them in the old books, right? Expound them. And I want to take a moment just to do this with you because, like I said, this is going to shed an incredible amount of light on what we're talking about here. And it's also, incidentally, going to make good on a promise I gave way back in From Darwin to Donald Trump. I said, you know, if you remember that series, in the first few episodes, I was at pains to lay out for you this sort of scandal that's going on where you have this subset of academics, you know, experts in our culture who are on the public microphones, doing the book tours, on the talk shows, etc. And they're telling you things that are just flatly false, but you wouldn't know they're flatly false unless you sort of dove into their field of expertise and started reading and got acquainted with the issues and the authors and so on and so forth. But they pull this scam over on you because most people don't have the time or inclination to do that. And I said, I'm going to show you, and I showed you a few instances of it, and then I said, there's tons more. But then, you know, we only have so much time and so many episodes to that series. So I said, you know, in the future, we'll be looking at more of this. Well, let's look at more of it right now. I want to introduce you to a gentleman real fast. All right. His name is Arthur Balfour. Arthur Balfour was one of the first prime ministers of England in the 20th century. And he held some other governmental positions, Secretary of Foreign Affairs, something like that. But most notably, Prime Minister of England. In addition to being a politician, or rather more fundamental than being a politician, he was a fantastic philosopher. You read some of these old English guys, man, takes a minute to get used to the style of writing, because not because the style of writing is difficult, it's because it's so unbelievably clear that you're just not used to it. It's painstakingly clear, and then it gets addictive after you start to read these guys. But this guy is just, he is an amazing philosopher and had a lot to say about the kinds of things we're talking about in this show. And he wrote a couple books. In fact, he gave a series of lectures at the University of Glasgow, a famous series of lectures that have been going on for 100 years called the Gifford Lectures, wherein a lot of this material is found. Arthur Balfour offered an argument in, I believe, 1894. You got to understand, when Darwin released his book, much of the reaction was on the sort of scientific empirical end. And rightly so. I mean, you know, there's some amazing contemporaries of Darwin who immediately identified some very significant problems that are still with us, though you wouldn't know it because we have these boisterous folks on the microphones telling you the problems have been solved. But nonetheless, much of the response immediately was about the sort of scientific-y end, the empirical end of what he was talking about. But as time went on, folks started to pick up on other implications of what Darwin was proposing. And Arthur Balfour is a guy who really, I think, better than anyone identified one of, if not the deepest problem that we would theoretically encounter if we took Darwin seriously. Well, actually, to be honest, like I might have said in a past episode, it was Darwin himself who suggested the problem at the end of his book, and it said it scared him to death. All right, but then he just makes this comment on it and he moves on. Well, folks picked up on that and they started exploring it, and none did it better than Arthur Balfour. Arthur Balfour has this book. I'm not going to go into the book. I'm going to quote you a little passage of this, but let me just explain to you what the general tenor, what the general idea of the argument is before we get into it. And let me just say, man, I know that, gosh, I sort of step back from the series and I look at it, and I know that what we're talking about is heavy. All right, this is heavy. Don't get me wrong. I'm a normal guy. There's a sense in which, you know, I'd rather be eating a bowl of cereal, you know? Well, there's a sense in which I'd always rather be eating a bowl of cereal. But look, we got to talk about this stuff. We have to talk about this stuff, or at least at a minimum, I got to tell you about this stuff. This is real world stuff. This is real-ish, you know? This is real. Marx happened. Communism happened. Those 94 million chalk outlines we spoke of happened. Prior to being chalk outlines, they were bodies on the ground. They became bodies on the ground because a belief system enveloped that country that required that they die in order to for it to succeed. All right? This happened. And this is our world. This is your world. This is my world. I like this world, you know. Most of it, a lot of it. Don't you? I want good things for it. And you and those who live in it, right? Misery sucks. Pain sucks. Crime sucks. Corruption sucks. To put it in Marxist terms, oppression sucks. I'm saying this because I think it's easy to hear some of Marx's more acerbic, pointed words and just kind of shake your head, or hear my expounding on the consequences of them, either one or both, and just sort of shake your head and go, yeah, man, that's crazy. That's not enough to say that. I'm not coming down on you. I want you to feel this point. That's not enough, because your judgment that it is crazy is based on certain moral principles in your mind, and those moral principles are ultimately based on certain moral intuitions that you have. But the whole question is, what is the foundation that legitimizes those intuitions? Incidentally, Balfour's book is called The Foundations of Belief. Because why is this important? Because Marx is just going to, if you object, yeah, that's crazy, Marx, he's just going to flip you off. And he's going to say, if you don't agree, then you're just a slave to the oppressive logic of the rich. All right? And he's going to be done with you, and he's going to move on, and he's going to advance his cause, or Antifa's going to advance his cause. You have to understand. It's not enough to have a feeling about something. You got to understand. For Marx, those intuitions that you have that lead you to say, that's nuts, they have no justifying basis. So you're irrelevant to him. They have no justifying basis because none do. Because justification itself, in this sense, is a matter of logic. See? And logic is one of those things that is being hung from the gallows in Marx's revolution. So if you want to be able to deal with him, you got to come to the question of the origin of your most basic intuitions. Marx is going to tell you they're simply a product of the blind material forces that created you, much like Darwin said that species are simply a product of the blind material forces that created them. Marx is going to say they're not worth a thing, and he's going to throw them into the burning blaze that he has ignited. And the question that we're facing here is not just, it's not just a question. This is the question that all of modern philosophy culminates in. Variants of this question is the question. It's got a couple different manifestations, but this is the issue. So I want to draw, do you remember, Midway through from Darwin to Donald Trump, I said, all these folks in the news, in popular culture, in the news media, all these folks have been fed a certain history of ideas in their college. They're all the educated class, right? The elites. They've all been fed a certain reading, a certain understanding of the history of ideas that plays out between Descartes and culminates in Darwin. And they believe it. They think it's obviously true. And it's because of the obviousness of this series of ideas to them. It's because it's so obvious that they treat the culture and you and the public, the deplorables, the way they do, because it's obvious to them. I want to dwell on this before we get into the historical bit about Antifa. Like I said, this is gonna illuminate so much, but you got to bear with me for the first few minutes, okay? So I've told you who Balfour is, and I've told you that, you know, when he comes around, when he writes in 1895, he's turning the attention from the sort of empirical questions and issues and objections to Darwin to a sort of wider range of considerations. Let me see if I can just summarize the issue for you. To understand it, you just have to understand what, in the philosophical sense, we mean when we say that something is, quote, blind to something else. Suppose that I ask you how you make all your decisions, and every decision, like all throughout the day, every decision, whether it's what to eat for breakfast or, you know, how to respond to the guy who just, you know, cut you off on the highway, or, and you say, well, I roll a die, whatever. Now, if that's true, if the way your actions are determined is simply a result of the roll of a die, all right, then what we would say, rightly, suppose you do something that would otherwise be really morally praiseworthy. Would we want to praise you for it? Because part of something being morally praiseworthy is it's being done because it's the moral thing to do, right? But you're not doing anything because it's the moral thing to do. You're doing everything you do because, well, the number one came up, or the number six came up, or the number three came up, right? So the basis of your decisions are blind to moral considerations. Do you see? And that affects what we'd want to say about the sort of moral, you know, reputation or the moral status of each of your otherwise moral decisions, or decisions that on the surface look like moral decisions. Because the process, here's the key point, the process that is generating your decision, generating your action, is blind to morality. So your decision to act in any given circumstance has nothing to do with morality. If what you end up doing does happen to be the moral thing, it's a total sheer coincidence. Do you see? Now, if you understand this, you can understand what the substance of Balfour's argument is. And the argument, you know, is spread out over the whole book because it touches everything. And he's at pains to show how it touches everything. But one of the things it touches is this moral issue that we're talking about here. Balfour says, look, I'm supposed to believe, according to Darwin, that my mind is a product of natural selection. My psyche is a product of natural selection. Okay. Well, natural selection is blind to moral considerations. On Darwin's theory, natural selection is a process that turns on the fulcrum of, or runs on the motor of, biological fitness. And biological fitness has nothing whatsoever to do with, you know, aesthetic fitness or moral fitness. Do you see? So if the process that created my mind is strictly a function of a mechanism that tracks and enhances biological fitness, then why on earth do I believe my mind when it tells me X is moral, Y is not, A is moral, B is not? In other words, why do I think my moral thoughts, which would presumably, putatively, be the basis of my moral actions, why do I think they're even remotely true? Why do I think I'm even remotely in touch with any moral truths whatsoever? Because my moral thoughts are produced by a process that knows nothing of morality. It's blind to it. So why should I think that my moral beliefs are accurate ever? Now, if this sounds, you know, outlandish, if it sounds cartoonish, if it sounds too strong to be true, you need to remember that I'm offering this as an instance of the kind of phenomenon that I touched on a lot in the first series, where there are problems that have been with us, that were introduced a long time ago, that have been with us, that continue to be with us, that do not have a solution in this sort of materialistic, Darwinistic, whatever you want to call it, naturalistic view of the world. But you have a subset of academics who are running around pretending like they don't exist, so they can further certain causes, all right? But I said there's also another group of academics who's actually pretty forthright, and the colleagues of these folks. And sometimes you'll get a hint, a glimmer, a peek behind the curtain from these folks about the fact that these problems still do persist. Well, enter philosopher Sharon Street, a current Princeton philosopher. In 2006, she writes an article about natural selection and moral beliefs. And this argument caused and continues to cause, this paper that she wrote caused and continues to cause a big stir. And guess what her argument is in this book, or sorry, in this paper? I bet if you think about it, you can guess it. Guess what her argument is? All right, it goes like this. I will just do it in several propositions. Premise one, human systems of moral and evaluative judgments are thoroughly saturated with evolutionary influence, just like we said, right? Because natural selection has shaped them. Premise two, natural selection selected for those moral and evaluative judgments according to, just like we said, biological fitness, i.e., rather than tracking moral truth, moral fitness, or aesthetic fitness, or anything like that, right? So, what can we conclude from these two propositions? We can conclude that if human moral beliefs are shaped by evolution, i.e., natural selection, And if they align with actual moral truths, like real moral truths, this is a complete coincidence, because there's nothing in the mechanism of natural selection that would track moral truth. Okay? But then she says, now this is the twist, she says, but of course we're not justified in thinking that any such coincidence has occurred, and therefore we're not justified in thinking that our moral beliefs accurately represent independent moral truths. See? Do you see what she's saying here? This is actually an argument against moral realism, like we talked about in the Charlie Gard series, that morality was a real, existing, objective, independent thing. So that if it's wrong for me to murder you or you to murder me, you know, 10,000 years ago, on one side of the globe, it's still wrong for me to murder you or you to murder me 10,000 years later on another side of the globe. It's a real truth. It doesn't change. Justice is a real thing, which is what Thrasymachus wanted to tell Socrates he was so deluded about. All right? So here's Sharon Street, 100 plus years later, you know, and her argument is identical to Balfour's. Of course, it's slightly different, right? The conclusion is different. Sharon Street's saying, well, then I guess we can't believe morality is real. Isn't it interesting? See, this is the ideology at work. Isn't it interesting what people are willing to give up? She's got, on the one hand, Darwinism and the naturalism, which sort of underpins Darwinism. On the other hand, she's got all her moral convictions about the truth of moral claims and the reality and the substance and the bindingness of morality. She says, well, I got to give one of these up. And the argument is compelling, that if I take Darwin seriously, then there should be no reason I know anything about morality. So I guess so much with morality, right? Of course, that's not what Balfour is doing, but the argument's the same. It's saying, look, if natural selection is the thing, then biological fitness is the thing. If biological fitness is the thing, then why would we think that our cognitive faculties, which were formed by natural selection, make any contact with, accurately track in any way, moral truth? Let me read you a paragraph from Balfour. I'll just read you a bit of this, all right? I'm not going to read you the argument. I just sort of summarize the argument. I'll just read you the sort of lead up to the argument. He says, the two subjects on which the professors of every creed, theological and anti-theological, seem least anxious to differ are the general substance of the moral law. You know, we all agree, you know, don't murder people. We all agree, don't rob people. We all agree, treachery is treacherous. We all agree, right, et cetera, right? He says, the things that everybody seems to agree on is the substance of the moral law for the most part. And listen to this, the character of the sentiments with which it should be regarded. In other words, we all agree, it's not just that certain things are moral and certain things are not. After all, I mean, don't get this twisted. Why is Antifa calling for a revolution? Because they think that fascism is immoral, right? Because they think a certain system of government, they're mistaken about, you know, where it's actually realized and when it's in place and when it's not and what it is. But because they think that it's immoral, and of course you would have to agree with them. You just don't agree with them that what they're calling fascism is fascism, right? And we'll see later that they have ulterior motives. So not only do we agree that on the basic moral truths, but we agree that you should think highly of morality. Otherwise, how else could you be compelled to follow it? It's not just, you know, well, I'll let Balfour say it. He says, it's worthy of our reverence. It demands our ungrudging submission, and that we owe it not merely obedience, but love. These are commonplaces which the preachers of all schools vie with each other in proclaiming. And he says, they're certainly right. Follow this now. One more paragraph. He says, morality is more than a bare code of laws, than a catalogue raisonné of things to be done or left undone. If it were otherwise, listen now, this is where we come to Marx. Were it otherwise, we must change something more important than the mere customary language of exhortation. We must, in other words, we would have to change more than how we try to implore each other to behave morally. He says, rather, here's what we'd have to change. The old ideas of the world would have to be, would have to be uprooted, and no new ones could spring up and flourish in their stead. The very soil on which they grew would be sterilized, and the phrases in which all that has hitherto been regarded as best and noblest in human life has been expressed, the phrases in which those things have been expressed, nay, the words, he says, best and noblest themselves would become as foolish and unmeaning as the incantation of a forgotten superstition. Why am I reading this at the beginning of another episode about Marx? Because what Balfour is saying, or what he's going to go on to say, is if you take Darwin's theory seriously, and Marx took it seriously, and Engels took it seriously, you know, and George Bernard Shaw, who said the world jumped at Darwin, George Bernard Shaw, who was an English communist, by the way, took it seriously. Balfour is going to say, if you take this seriously, then the idea that we should revere and think highly of morality, let alone that we should know anything of moral truths, is nonsense. See what's going on here? And we would have to accept that. And therefore, all the old ideas of morality on which all of our moral, you know, moral framework and judicial framework, all these ideas would have to be utterly uprooted and nothing could grow in their place. Do you see why this is important to Marx? Because this is the scientific end. This is the theoretical end of exactly what Marx said needed to happen. This total revolution. Darwin is accomplishing it for him. Do you see? If there's no reason to think that we know moral truth, and there's no reason to prize moral truths or moral principles or maxims above any other kind of principle or maxim, if there's no reason to revere it, well, then all bets are off. And that's what Marx wants. You should hear Marx talk about the reaction to Darwin when he wrote among him and his colleague, fellow communists. You should hear Engels talk about how and other colleagues of these guys, other peers, talk about how for months they talked about nothing but Darwin when they first discovered Darwin and how important Darwin was to the communist cause. All right? This is why I mentioned this at the top. This is a problem. Like Balfour said in his quote, we're not just talking about tearing down some set of judgments that has historically been agreed upon all sides as are basically true. He said, we're talking about tearing down the thing in us that believes that any such judgment can be true. This accomplishes exactly the kind of revolution, categorical revolution of thought, and revolution of categorical thought that Marx was calling for. Like Balfour said, this is why he says nothing else can grow in its place, but something else will have to take its place. And what is it? What does a communist say to this? They say, yes, the state. Right? The state will do that. Like Mao said, we'll determine truth. This, incidentally, to go back an episode or two, I would tell Ms. or Mrs., I don't know, is it? Is it still Mrs. Clinton? This is the point of 2 + 2 = 5 in 1984. I don't know what she was talking about. All right, well, you know, a while back I put a quick video up on social media, a little quiz question. We need to address this, right? Because I haven't touched on it yet. We're gonna provide the answer to the quiz question here in this section. But in order to do it, and I know I said this is gonna be history. We are gonna touch on history, but listen, to understand what Antifa is, even historically, there's something we got to appreciate here, and it's something we actually often have to come back to, dealing as we are with philosophy. We have to appreciate how subtle and how powerful of a weapon language can be. Maybe you've already gotten a picture of that. I mean, I emphasized through the early part of this series how important it is to understand the two different possible logical structures of a statement, of two seemingly identical statements, right? All the best basketball players are from Norway. Conceived empirically, you would think that I'd gone out and found the best basketball players and then independently confirmed that they're also Norwegian. But conceived of ideologically, what you discover is that I'm just saying I define best basketball players as being Norwegian. You have to understand how powerful of a weapon language can be. All right? And I know I said this is going to be historical, but we got to do this. We got to just dwell on language here for a minute, okay? To understand the historical bit. What is it about language that I'm going to say here that we got to understand in order to understand Antifa's history? Well, look, to touch on this quiz that we did a while ago, I just want you to think about the following four terms, what they mean. So here's four terms. One, climate denier. Two, evolution denier. Three, Islamophobic. Four, transphobic. Or I think maybe in the quiz I said homophobic. Well, whatever, it doesn't really matter. What you got to notice in each of these cases, and these are pretty standard examples, right? These days of things you might hear a leftist, you know, shout at another person, accuse another person of being. You got to notice that in each case, the name or the label that's being applied carries with it a connotation that is by design not neutral. That is, it's meant to move the debate in a given direction. In the first two instances, climate denier and evolution denier. In these cases, the usage of the term denier is what's crucial. The idea is that whatever is being said to be denied is itself so obvious that being a denier of it, you know, would be ridiculous. So to accuse somebody of being a denier of it is to destroy a person's standing as being a clear-thinking, intelligent person. Oh, you're a denier? Really? See, you're calling someone a denier in this sort of context is an insult, but it couldn't be an insult unless what was being said to be denied was not only true, but obvious. That's the important point, obvious. Why does it have to be obvious? Well, think of something really complicated, right? Well, you have a situation where there's a significant debate between two sides about something that's very complex, like quantum mechanics. You're just not going to hear a defender of the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics calling a defender of the pilot wave interpretation, you know, a denier, right? Because quantum mechanics is far too difficult, far too not obvious for that to make any sense. You're a denier is not an effective indictment unless what's being said to be denied is in fact obvious, and nothing about quantum mechanics is obvious except for the fact that nothing about quantum mechanics is obvious. So to call someone a climate change denier is not just to describe their position, it's to judge their position implicitly, ipso facto. And in judging their position, it's moving the debate away from the point or points, you know, on which the person who's being called the denier would naturally want to have the debate, namely the facts, right? Like Marx, like Hegel, damn the facts, right? In fact, we've seen Marx, as an ideologue in general, has no patience for facts or debate where they don't fit the ideology, where they don't fit the framework, where they don't fit the model. Ooh, the model. You see how this is working? So for instance, if you want to discuss the fact that, you know, major assessments and predictions based on those assessments regarding the global temperature increases from that, you know, the United Nations panel proved, you know, by the data to be totally inaccurate. If you want to talk about that, and why those predictions turned out to be inaccurate, you'll just be called a denier. What this does is quickly categorize you as someone who denies the obvious, the consensus science, and it calls your motives into question, and calls your intelligence into question, and it moves the debate away from the substance. Do you see? Rather in the direction of your psychology, your character, ooh, your logic, which has now been indicted. Incidentally, you know, and what did they do to fix that problem with the data? They changed the model. They changed the framework. They said, no, look, it's increasing how we said. We just had to change the assumptions surrounding the data. See, they adjust the framework. They're still looking through the blue tinted lenses. The same thing happens in the context of evolutionary debates or debates about certain aspects of evolution. If you want to, for instance, if you want like a proponent of evolution to make clear to you how they reconcile the really significant structural differences between that theory and other, you know, really well-known paradigm, well-established scientific theories, you'll be called a denier, right? Or, for instance, you know, I said we were talking about old books earlier. Well, someone who wrote immediately following Darwin, who's probably one of the best critics of Darwin, comes way back in Darwin's day, George Jackson Mivart. Man, you got to read this guy. Famous for sort of like best articulating an argument, which was essentially, look, please explain to me how incremental, tiny variations from one generation to the next of a species are supposed to be preserved and built upon if they are, by definition, not, if they lack, by definition, utility. I mean, this is what Darwin is saying, right? It's like, so you have all these random, unhelpful mutations that eventually conglomerate into something that's helpful and the helpful thing's preserved. Okay, but that takes millions. I mean, how many generations, how many life cycles does that take? How are they preserved in the meantime? Since on Darwin's theory, something can only be preserved if it's useful, or we can only know that it's likely to be preserved if it's useful, or the only argument for how historically it was preserved was its utility. Mivart said, you want to explain that? Because we know that arms don't just pop out, right? On Darwin's theory, this, you know, whatever appendage or whatever, you know, morphological feature or phenotypical feature you're speaking of took forever to develop. But in that time, forever, it was not useful, right? So how did it? So how was it preserved in order to develop? So Mivart pointed this out. But if you point this out, and Mivart was called a denier too, if you point this out or ask about it, it's a very rational question, you'll just be called a denier. And what this does is it categorizes you, right? Stop me if you've heard this one. Categorizes you as someone who denies the obvious, denies consensus science, and therefore it calls your motives into question, thus moving the debate, you get it, away from the facts and towards your character. Okay? Your character, your thinking, your logic. Oh, your logic. Marxism. Your logic need not be dealt with. It's irrelevant. You're a denier. We know your true motives. Let's not even discuss the facts because we know your motives, so the facts are unimportant. It's not important, right? It's not ultimate. Logic's not ultimate for Marx. The goal is ultimate. The framework is ultimate. The vision, the revolution, the lens, the vision, the model, the lens, the ideology, the theory. Uphold evolution at all costs. That's the important thing. Adjust the facts to make it work. All right? What about these other two? Well, look at the other two. Numbers 3 and 4. Transphobic and Islamophobic. If you're a person that wants to, for instance, discuss the moral status of, you know, transsexual, you know, behavior or surgery, or, you know, if you just want to understand, see, I want to understand the actual arguments and rationale for those who assert that this is morally acceptable because it's not clear to me. The moment you say that, you're called transphobic. And what this is meant to do is reduce your rational inquiry to the level that is sub-rational. And how do they do that in this context? You'll know this as soon as I say it. It will be said to be motivated by fear and hatred. Love wins, after all, right? Fear and hatred. Fear and hatred are emotions. They're not rational. They're sub-rational. So they can't serve unassisted as the basis for any argument. So by attributing your rational inquiry to being really grounded in fear and hatred, see, you're full of fear. You're full of hate. Next, by doing this, the grounds of the debate is moved past your position in order to avoid it. You're going to find the same thing with Islamophobic, right? I mean, you can see it by now, right? If you're a person that just wants to ask whether it's really possible or realistic that members of a belief system, you know, adherence to a belief system, the fundamental tenets of which are utterly, at their most basic level, contradictory to the view of, you know, organized religion's relation that's foundational to our society. If you want to just ask how that sort of like melting pot action is supposed to happen when they are diametrically opposed at a most fundamental level, you're not denying it can happen. You're just like, well, how is this supposed to go through? If you ask that, well, you're Islamophobic. See? You're full of fear. You're full of hate. We don't have to deal with the rational basis of your inquiry. We're just going to call you full of fear and hate. Seeing the pattern here? The grounds of the debate are moved past your position, moved past the facts in order to avoid them. Now, okay, so that's what all of those four terms, and many like them, have in common. So there's the answer to the quiz question. What does this have to do with Antifa? Now we come to the historical point. Antifa was a movement that began in early 20th century, you know, Germany. And it sought, or claimed to seek, to prevent Nazism, a form of fascism, from taking hold there. And it used, you know, rioting, anarchy, violence, terrorism, and so forth as a means towards that goal. But here's the thing. The people who this movement comprised were, are you ready? Who were they? They were communists. They were Marxists in Germany who sought to extend communism to Germany And of course, to the whole world, because that's the essence of communism, right? It's supposed to be this global takeover. Sorry, Islamophobic, global takeover. Oh, interesting. Interesting confluence of goals there. Pardon me. So what does this have to do with the language analysis we just did? You know, let alone what does it have to do with the present day incarnation of the Antifa movement? Well, think about the function that the name of this group serves in bringing about the cause that they're working towards. Or rioting towards, whatever you want to say. Think about it. If I tell you that I'm anti-fascist, and if you then oppose me, then I can accuse you of being, get it, pro-fascist. After all, it's simple logic, right? Two negatives make a positive. If you're not anti-fascist, well, then you must be anti-anti-fascist. You must be pro-fascist. You must be, wait for it, a Nazi. See? So I can just proceed to yell Nazi at you. I can attack you, I can bomb you, I can beat you, I can burn you, I can shout you down, whatever. I can loot you, I can, you know, loot your store, and so forth. And if anyone inquires to the moral justification of my actions, well, I can say I'm fighting Nazis. I'm righteous, man. See, do you see the trick that's being played here? It's a simple fallacy. It's for you logic, you college students. It's a formal fallacy. It's a false dichotomy. The whole thing hangs on the assumption that there is only one way to be anti-fascist, and that is to be a communist. See? So the term Antifa implicitly presents you with a false choice, a false dichotomy. Antifa is historically and essentially a communist group, so they label themselves Antifa in order to implicitly label any opponent as being pro-fascist. They didn't label themselves, you know, pro-co, do you see? They labeled themselves negatively. Not pro-co, but Antifa. So to label themselves Antifa is implicitly to label any opponent as being pro-fascist. But of course, that could only be an accurate categorization if the only two choices available are, in fact, fascist and communist. Because it's only if communism is the only way to avoid being a fascist. It's only if that's true that it would then be true that being anti-anti-fascist means you're, in fact, a fascist. Do you see? And that is exactly what the communists want you to believe, which is why they've labeled themselves this way. And that was the historical point now. That was historically exactly the reason that the Antifa groups in the early 20th century came up with the name. They wanted to reduce the choice to that between fascism and communism, i.e. definitely not allowing into the discussion anything resembling Americanism, American liberty, freedom, capitalism, personal political freedom, etc. So they simply created a name that eliminated the possibility of what they didn't want to discuss, moving the debate past the facts, right? From the outset, Mussolini came to power in Italy by advancing the idea that the only relevant choice facing Italy was that choice, fascism or communism. Hitler did the same thing, all right? You see how this works? You see the assumption at work? In fact, let's talk about Hitler for a second. This is interesting. We can confirm this in two ways, sort of one historical and the other conceptual. Historically, I mean, it's known, it's documented that the communists in Germany ordered their members, really, you got to appreciate the irony in this or the pointedness of this, ordered their members to vote for the Nazis in the 1933 election. Now, wait a second. What? Halt? Stop? Why would they do that? I thought they were Antifa. I thought they were anti-fascist. And they say, you must vote for the fascists. See, if the only choice to make was between Nazism and communism, if in fact these two were the arch rivals they pretended to be, then why would the one command their members to vote for the other? You gotta understand the significance of this to see the full connection here. This whole series is driving at, and that we're now, I would say, basically at the point of realizing. Do you see it? See, the very same thing that Mussolini was doing, the very same thing that Hitler was doing is exactly what's at work in the name Antifa. You're being given a false choice. You're being given a set of two options that make pretense of being the only two options, of being all there is to choose between. And if you oppose the one, therefore, if you oppose Antifa, therefore, you're then said to be ipso facto embracing the other. I mean, if you're not for Antifa, then you must be a fascist, because those are the only two options. But then again, why did they then vote for the fascists? I hope you see the answer. Because, of course, they knew they know, I'm going to put in present day terms, that what they're really trying to do is destroy the third option. That's what they have in common. That's their common cause. See, they look like enemies on the surface. They're not. Conceptually, they do this by eliminating at the definitional level, in the very name of their group, eliminating the third option. And this is just what Antifa's done. This is why language is so important. See, politically, they were just acting in a way that's consistent with what they were trying to accomplish. You might say, wait, I get the conceptual point about the name. I get what you're saying about the logic, the assumption, et cetera. But why do you say that what they were doing was politically consistent? I mean, after all, these are two different political views, right? Communism on the one hand and fascism, Nazism on the other. How can it be said that the members of one group were voting for the other in a way that was politically consistent? And you might think that the answer to that question is just sort of like a pragmatic, lesser of two evils, you know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend type of consideration, but you'd be wrong. Let's dig into this. Listen, it's not merely a tactical or pragmatic strategy. It is politically consistent because it is philosophically consistent. And to see this, you just have to sort of dig into what these two supposedly different views, two different political philosophies, have to say about the nature of the individual person's relation to society and thus to the government, to the state. There is no more fundamental political question than this. So if we go down to the bottom and we find agreement on this point, well, then their actions will make perfect sense, won't they? Remember, in our review of Marxism and communism, we've already seen half of this, in a sense. For Marx, and actually we touched on this in the Charlie Gard series as well, for Marx, the collective, the group, the state is everything. The individual does not matter. In fact, the very notion that there is something fundamental, something primary about something, you know, sacrosanct, about something, you know, theoretically, morally, metaphysically fundamental or important about individuals, about individual persons, is as much an oppressive construct pushed upon the working class by the propertied class as are, as we saw, all the ideas that, as Marx says, have been transformed by the rich into eternal laws of nature and reason. When in fact, says Marx, they are merely, the social forms springing from the present mode of production and, you know, thus foisted upon the working class in the greatest, you know, scam of all time, and hence the need for revolution. Now, of course, among those ideas that Marx says that the working masses are fooled into thinking are real, independent, existing laws of morality and so forth, among those ideas just is the moral principle that asserts that individuals, you know, in their natural rights like liberty and property and stuff, you know, which Marx admits are two sides of the same coin. Remember that. He said they go hand in hand. Among those things that Marx is trying to tell you are things that have to be eradicated is the very idea that individuals are the fundamental unit of society. It's really important to understand what's meant by the assertion of rights like liberty and property, natural rights, as the founders of America and the philosophers from whom they were drawing asserted. I really recommend you check out the previous series because that subject is covered extensively there. But for the moment, it just, you know, it'll be enough to say that humans have natural rights is to assert exactly the kind of eternal principle that Marx is taking aim at, that he wants to do away with, that he wants to uproot. Marx is denying all of this. Communism denies all of this. There are no natural rights. There are no lasting eternal principles of justice and morality on which the legal system can be based and therefore be accurate or right or just or not. All of it's a ruse. All of it's a scam that the rich have pulled on you. And I mean, you see what follows, right? If there's no natural rights, then there's no individual rights. And if there's no individual rights, then individuals are nothing. They're irrelevant. And for Marx, they are irrelevant. The group, the state, the collective is the only relevant entity. The individual has to bow, to sacrifice for, or be sacrificed to the state.
As I've said since we began this campaign, we're going to have to return to a spirit of service and sacrifice.
Oops. That was a little unplanned technical glitch. I promise. Totally unplanned. Totally accidental, right? All right. The abstract everyone, society. The individual has no identity or importance apart from it. Now I want to ask you a core question, and it's this. In fact, I already answered it, but I want to just check to make sure you get what I'm driving at here. What more fundamental question could there be? What more basic distinction could there be for distinguishing between different kinds of sociopolitical systems than this? Man's relation to the government, to the state, is the driving consideration in any inquiry into the, you know, proper mode of political organization. So obviously, there's no more fundamental question than this. This is it. And as we said a few minutes ago, and as we've just reviewed, we've seen Marx's answer to it. We've seen communism's answer to it. It's the omelet, man. The eggs are irrelevant. Now think back to our main issue here and the question that arose out of it. Why does Antifa found its very identity on a false dichotomy? The nature of which, you know, is to just implicitly conceal the possibility of being anything other than a communist or a fascist. Why do they do that? Answer, because they wanted to leave out of the equation, out of the options, just as Hitler did, just as Mussolini did, the possibility of considering the idea of man's relation to the state that is fundamental to our tradition, to America. Okay? They wanted to leave out the possibility, I'm going to say this again, leave out of consideration any discussion of the idea of man's relation to the state, the conception of man's relation to the state that is fundamental to America. Fundamental. Do you understand?
We are 5 days away from fundamentally transforming the United States of America.
Oops. Sorry. Another technical difficulty there. Sorry. That was an accident, of course. All right. I mean, do you see the point now? Why, though pretending to be opposites, though pretending to be at war with one another, why do their allied actions, like we just mentioned the historical point about the communists voting for the fascists, why does it make sense? I said it's not just an enemy of my enemy is my friend type of situation here. It's not merely the hatred for American freedom, liberty, etc. caused the communists in Germany to demand that their party members vote for the Nazis. It's that, this is what I'm driving at. I hope you see it now. It's that they agree on the most basic point. Look what we've just said about the most basic distinction you can make in delineating, in grouping, in categorizing various schemes of political organization. The question that divides the field at its most basic level is, what is man's relation to the government, to the state? Who has all the rights? Who has the priority? Do you see? Let me just push you a little bit. What is so different about Nazism? What distinguishes Nazism from communism? Is it something like central and fundamental, you know, and consequential, or is it just something peripheral and trivial? What is man's relation to the state under fascism? Well, you'll find that it's the same thing. You know, I'm not a big objectivist or libertarian or any of that, the sort of positive end of Ayn Rand's philosophy. But one of her expositors has a great sort of negative piece on this. I'm going to read you just a quick summary of what we're driving at here about this issue. He says this is Leonard Peikoff. He says both of these are variants of statism, based on the collectivist principle that man is the rightless slave of the state. Both are socialistic in theory and in practice and in the explicit statement of their leaders, that under both systems, the poor are enslaved and the rich are expropriated in favor of a ruling clique. That fascism is not the product of the political right. Rather, it's as Antifa wants you to believe, fascism is the product of the political left, the same as the communists. That the basic issue is not rich versus poor, but man versus the state. Or, you know, said another way, individual rights versus totalitarian government. And what that boils down to is capitalism versus socialism. Do you see? The main characteristic of socialism, and, you know, like Marx said, communism, is the public ownership of the means of production and therefore the abolition of private property. The right to property is the right to use and dispose of things. And that's gone under communism. What about fascism? Well, under fascism, men retain the semblance of or a pretense of that right to property, but the government holds total power over its use and disposal. Under fascism, citizens retain responsibilities of owning property, but they don't have the freedom to act regarding it and without any of the advantages of ownership, like that freedom to act. Under socialism, government officials acquire all the advantages of ownership without any of the responsibilities, since they do not hold the title to the property, but merely the right to use it. At least, you know, until the next purge, he says. But here's the point. In either case, the government officials hold the economic, political, and legal power of life and death over the citizens. Under both systems, sacrifice is invoked as some sort of magic, omnipotent solution in any crisis, and the public good, the omelet, to put it in our terms, is the altar on which victims are immolated, or sacrificed, however you want to say it. You see? You see the historical point? The point is, again, why did the communists vote for the fascists? It's only understandable in light of this conceptual point, which we've just drawn out. It was philosophically consistent for them to do so, because communism and fascism absolutely effing agree on the most fundamental political question there is. What's man's relation to the state? Both agree that man, individual, particular people, you, me, your mom, etc., are nothing. Individuals don't matter. The state matters. The group. That's why they're called statists, right? The collective. That's the fundamental thing. Everything must be sacrificed for that. So, let me reverse the question as we close out here. Why wouldn't the communists vote for the fascists? See the point? Why would they? Why would anti-fascists explicitly tell their members to vote for fascists? Because at bottom, they share the same vision of society. Statism. The individual's nothing. The government is all. The individual does not matter. The group, the collective, is the thing. And any individual right, and therefore any individual, since the right to life is an individual right, can be and ought to be, if need be, must be, sacrificed to achieve the vision, the model, see? The revolution. 94 million chalk outlines, remember? 94 million. 94 million unique individual persons had to die for the model, for the vision of the collective. Because the individual persons don't matter, the state is what matters. And this is what is common to both systems. And this forms the substance of the secret handshake that they've devised in their war against, well, Americanism, against freedom, against liberty. And just as it was in the early 20th century, so it is now. Antifa is not an anti-fascist group. It's a pro-collectivist, pro-statist group. It's a communist group. And fascists themselves are pro-statist, pro-collectivist as well. What they are both aligned with is their perpendicular square opposition to individual freedom, individual liberty, natural rights, and everything on which this country was founded. All right, now we got to get out of here. I'm over an hour. We come back, last episode, you're not going to want to miss it, because I've been saying, and in the title of this series, we said we're going to unmask Antifa. It's going to be painful, but we're going to do it. We're going to see who is the face behind this mask. My name is Nick. It's the 40 Ounce Hemlock Podcast. Thanks for bearing with us on this first hour-long episode, and I'll see you in part 10 of Unmasking Antifa.